If you could, guys, turn me down just a little bit, if you don't care. All right. So, if you're a first-time guest or a visitor this morning, we want to tell you we're glad you're here. Glad you're here. Or maybe it's just the first time you've been back in a while. We're still glad you're here. I want to tell you one quick thing before we get into the message today. We would love to hear your story, and what I mean by that is we all have a story of how God's changed our life, and we probably all have been impacted by this church, and so we would love to hear your story. And so if you'd like to share your story with us, or if you'd like to share how this church has impacted your life, if you'd like to share maybe we do something that you really like, or maybe we do something that you don't really like, you can share all of that with us by emailing us at mystory@bondbaptist.com. mystory@bondbaptist.com. And so you can send that in. And we'd love to hear from you, love to hear your opinion, and we'd love to hear about what God's doing in your life. So if you want to, you can email us at mystory@bondbaptist.com. So with that being said, we're in a series on focus, and in the first week, we talked about the fact that God wants us to live a focused life, a focused life. And last week, we talked about how that the focus of our life ought to be the gospel about Jesus Christ, the good news about Jesus. And today, I want to continue in the idea of living a life of focus, a life of focus. So if you have your Bible, turn with me to Luke 10, 25-42. Now, there's several scriptures here. It's two different stories recorded by Luke, and Luke was a doctor who researched Jesus, but these were two stories, and they just happened to be side by side, but I don't know if I've ever heard them preach together. And so we're going to try it today. Luke 10:25-42. So if you have your Bible, open up there. If you don't have a Bible, there's one in front of you. And like always, if you don't own a Bible, you can take that home with you. But we'll jump in because there's several verses to read. It says, And behold, a lawyer stood up to him, put him to the test, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, What is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your might. And you love your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And so likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? And he said, The one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, You go and do likewise. Then in 38 it says, Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village. And a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teachings. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, why are you anxious and troubled about many things? But one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. Let's pray together. Lord, we come to you this morning, and more than anything, we realize that we need you. We need you in our lives. We need you in this moment, Father. We need you in this church. And we pray that you would just come and rest in this place while we're here. And that you and your presence would change our hearts and our minds, Father. I pray that you would move on me, Father, change my heart. Father, I pray that as I speak, that I wouldn't speak my words, but your words, Father. Hide me behind your cross. And Father, I pray that this would touch someone's life this morning. We love you and thank you, and it's through Jesus we pray. Amen. Have you ever felt like your life is out of control? Like that life is so hectic and chaotic. Like that it's just spinning out of control and you don't know how to stop it. Have you felt like that? That life gets so fast sometimes and there's so much to do and so little time to do it. Have you experienced this where that I have a week's worth of work and I have one day to do it? I feel like this a lot of the time. And part of that results from me having a problem saying no. I say yes too much. And people ask me to do stuff and I always say yes. And I guess that's honorable at some level, but it creates a life that's hectic. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? That there's just so much to do and people, seems like everybody who talks to you needs something from you or needs you to do something. Do you know what I'm talking about this morning? Living like that gets old and it gets old fast. It's exhausting and I believe that it's unhealthy. But even more than all of that, I believe that that's not the life that God wants for us. That's not the life that He has intended for us. God does not want us to live this busy, hectic, crazy life. And I believe that that's what He wants to teach us through these two passages of Scripture that we read this morning. And I want to show you that. In the first story that we read, Jesus is speaking to a lawyer and to a crowd of people, a crowd of religious people. And the man is trying to trick Jesus into telling him how to get into the kingdom of heaven. What rules he had to follow to get into the kingdom of heaven. This man was a lawyer. So we all know to be wary of lawyers. But Jesus outthunk the lawyer. And he tells this story. He says, there was a man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho and he fell among thieves. And when he fell among thieves, they beat him and they battered him and they bruised him and they left him naked to die on the side of the road. And he was literally dying on the side of the road when a priest walks by. A priest walks by, and so this man's laying on the side of the road, and when this priest sees him, he goes way to the other side of the road to get around him. And now, I know that we give this priest a hard time when we hear this story of the Good Samaritan. We say, well, why don't he stop? Why don't he do something? Well, I tell you why I think that he doesn't do something. I believe he's busy. I believe that this man of God, who's the equivalent of a modern day pastor, he probably had other things on his mind. He was probably on his way to preach a sermon or to make a sacrifice. He may have been on the way to the hospital to visit somebody, and when he seen that person, he had so much going on in his life that he just had to pass by. He couldn't handle anymore. And then likewise, a Levite, who would have been the modern day equivalent of a deacon, He sees the same man. And he passes by that man. And he leaves him there on the side of the road to die. But I don't believe either of these men had bad intentions. I don't believe these men didn't have any compassion. I believe that they had full schedules. They had so much going on. Maybe this Levite was headed to the deacon's meeting. Maybe he was headed to the business meeting. Maybe he had something going on that he had to be to. And he was just so overwhelmed with all of the good things that he was doing that he had to pass this man by. I don't believe they were evil men. I don't believe that they had bad intentions towards this man. I believe that they were simply busy. I mean, after all, they were on the Lord's business. And it sounds so spiritual when we say that we're busy about the Lord's business. We have so much going on that there's no way we could possibly fit another thing in our schedule. It makes us sound spiritual, but really, it's quite the opposite. When you have so much going on that you can't stop to help someone, you have too much going on. These men probably had their days planned out to the second, but they had not scheduled any time to lend a helping hand. These men were busy doing good things. They were busy doing good things. That's what I need you to realize this morning. They were busy doing good things. Just like many of you are busy doing good things. But not every good thing is a God thing. Not every good thing is a God thing. Not every good opportunity is a God opportunity. And so in life, we'll have many opportunities to do good things. People will approach us with a program or with a ministry that is a good thing. But not every good thing is a God thing. You don't have to say yes to every good thing that somebody offers you to do. You all look like I just shot your dog. I said you don't have to do every good thing that somebody affords you the opportunity to do. There's two categories of things. There's good things and there's God things. And if you fill your schedule with good things, if you fill your schedule with good things, with good opportunities, you will never experience the God things. Because you have to choose whether you're going to do good things or God things. And they are not the same. Good things take up your time, but they do not have any profit. There's no output. There is no benefit. It's just a good thing, a good idea, a good intention. But a God thing, you'll see fruit from it. You'll see lives change. You'll see people impacted. Not every good thing is a God thing. We can get so busy serving the Lord that we can't serve the Lord. Amen. We can get so busy serving the Lord that we can't serve the Lord. I've been there, done that. I've been there. We can get so busy serving the Lord that we can't serve the Lord. In the next story, we see a couple sisters, and their names are Mary and Martha. And this is not Jesus' mother, Mary. It's a different Mary who's a friend of Jesus. And these sisters hear that Jesus is coming to town, and Martha, evidently, she owns the house or is the caretaker of it, and she starts cleaning. She hears that Jesus is coming and she knows that Jesus will stop by, and so she starts cleaning bathrooms and she starts a roast in the crock pot because she knows that Jesus loves roast, and she starts peeling potatoes and she starts sweeping up and she starts dusting, and it's just there's pillows flying everywhere and there's garbage bags everywhere and it's just a chaos. I mean, she's just trying to get everything done. She wants the house to look great for Jesus, and that's all good and well. That's all good and well. I'm sure that everything that Martha was trying to do needed to be done. She was not just making up things to do. The potatoes really needed to be peeled. And the floors really needed to be swept. But Luke records about Martha. It says that Martha was distracted with much serving. She was distracted by much serving. She was so busy trying to serve the Son of God, some roast and mashed potatoes. She got so focused on what she was trying to do that she lost sight of who she was doing it for. She was so busy, worried about serving Jesus that she lost sight of Jesus. She was doing good things. Things that needed to be done. But what she didn't realize is she had so much on her plate that it was keeping her from the presence of God. The two men in the first story, they were distracted by spiritual things. Martha, she was distracted by physical things, household things. What are you distracted by? What are you distracted by? What do you get so caught up in that you can't do meaningful ministry? What do you get so caught up in? What are you so distracted by? What are you giving your time to that you can't spend time in the presence of God? I think that that phrase, distracted with, with much serving, could describe most of the modern day church. We get so busy on filling jobs and getting stuff done at church and showing up and making sure that the ministry's still run that we lose sight of who we are serving. We can get so worried about serving Jesus that we don't spend any time with Him. We can get so busy serving Jesus that we don't spend any time with Him. Let me give you a hard truth this morning. Your serving is worthless if it is not coming from an overflow of spending time in the presence of God. If you're serving out of obligation, you might as well stop. If your service to this church or to wherever you serve is not coming out of the overflow of your heart when you spend time with God, would you stop? Really, I'm not joking. Because if you are serving out of obligation and not out of a deep love and devotion to our Savior, you're not doing anything anyway. You're just spinning your wheels. You have missed the entire point. Our service must come out of our time spent in the presence of God. Here's what I want you to take away. Serving God is not a substitute for spending time in the presence of God. Serving God is not a substitute for spending time in the presence of God. I'm going to say it one more time because I want you to know this. Serving God, showing up at church, doing good things, being here all the time, is not a substitute for spending time in the presence of God. We need time every single day in the presence of God. Because the presence of God changes our lives. I'm not talking about just a passing prayer when you wake up in the morning, but I'm talking about time spent when you say, this time is yours, God. I'm not going to look at my phone. I'm not going to watch TV. I'm going to focus in on your presence. I need your presence in my life. I heard a preacher say one time that everyone desires the presence of God's power, but we're not willing to spend time in the power of His presence. That means that we want God to show up and do miracles in our church. We want to see Him move in our lives. We want to win lost people to Jesus. We want to see God's power on display. But we're not willing to spend the time in His presence. We're not willing to push away from the world and to say no to some distractions. We're not willing to take some quiet time away to ourselves and find the presence of God. We want His power without His presence. But this morning, church, if you want His power, first find His presence. His power follows His presence. And so if you will get into the presence of God, you will find His power. His power will be at work in your life. Many times we're caught up in doing good things, but at the end of the day, we have no time left over to spend in the presence of God. As a church and as individuals, we're going to have many good opportunities. We're going to have the chance to do some good things. But we have to learn to say no to good things so that we can say yes to God things. Every opportunity that we are afforded is not a God opportunity. But we have to spend time in His presence so that when that time comes, we can discern what is good and what is God. You cannot do both. If you take up all your time doing good things, you'll never do God things. I believe this morning that we have an enemy. And he's the enemy of our soul, and he is the enemy of this church, and he is the enemy of every single person in here. And his tactic for you, it may not be to tempt you with bad things, it may be to tempt you with good things. If Satan cannot get you to say no to Jesus, he will get you so busy that you are rendered ineffective for the kingdom of heaven. He will have you doing so many things that you can't do nothing right. That you won't be able to do anything with excellence. Satan rarely tries to get us busy doing bad things. Most of the time, he'll tempt you to do so many good things that at the end of the day, you've done nothing at all. I don't believe that God has called us to a hectic life. A life that's so busy that we just barely scrape by. I've heard many times this acronym for busy, that it's busy under Satan's yoke. That busyness is actually a tactic of the enemy. And so if you are going through life and the things that you are doing are weighing you down, they're heavy burdens, and they're hard for you to do, those might not come from Jesus. If you're always restless, if you're always worried, if you're always anxious, the things that you are doing may be burdens from Satan and not tasks from God. You have to discern those things. Jesus says in Matthew 11:28, "Come to me, all who are who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. But yet today so many Christians are burdened down by the weight of good things. So busy that they can't spend time in this rest that Jesus wants to give us. So burdened down and distracted by the things of this world, by good things, that we don't get to experience the rest that Jesus offers. Jesus didn't promise us anxiety, worries, or burdens. He promised us rest in Him. You can rest in Him. His burden is easy and His yoke is light. Satan understands that if he can get you busy doing good things, that you will fall out of love with God. Let me say that again. Satan understands that if he can get you busy, get you distracted, then you will fall out of love with God. What I mean by that is that there's times in our life where we fall in love with God, where we have a passion, a zeal for God. I was saved 10 years and I didn't have a passion for God. But in 3 days in September of 2012, I got a passion, a love for God. I experienced something where I encountered the risen Savior, and I had a love for God. But over time, I got distracted by good things in my life. Will you do this? Will you do this? Will you lead that? Will you take care of that? And I said, yes, 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 because I had a passion for God. But what I didn't know is saying yes to the things because of my passion for God would lead me to lose my passion for God. Because I got so worried about this and this and this and this and doing good and doing good and doing good, that I didn't have time to spend in the presence of God. Busyness will lead you to lose your passion for God, and it will lead you to be ineffective in the ministry. What I didn't say is that God will fall out of love with you. God loves you no matter what, but our love for Him can be effective. So busyness robs us of our joy and our love for God. It turns our meaningful ministry into simply busy work. I wonder if that's what happened to David. And David, in Psalms 51:11, David says this, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit." I wonder if David had got so distracted by leading the kingdom and doing all of his kingly duties that he lost sight of God. He lost his passion, and he realized that, and he had to come back and say, "Lord, I need the joy of my salvation back." Have you lost your joy in your salvation? Do you remember when you were a kid and you were in school and the teacher was gone, and so there would be a substitute, and inevitably when the teacher was gone and there was a substitute, there would be some work left, and most of the time the work was busy work. It was just proof that you done something while the teacher was gone. Do you know what I'm talking about? Or at least that's what there might have been meaning behind it. I don't know. But that's what it felt like, right? That this is useless. I already know this stuff, but the teacher has left me this busy work. Jesus is not into busy work. Jesus is not into busy work. He's not just left us a bunch of tasks here for us to do so that when He comes back, we can prove to Him that we done something while He was gone. Now, Jesus wants us to be effective in ministry. He wants us to be effective in ministry. He doesn't give us work so that we look busy. He gives us work so that we can change lives. Many Christians today are simply doing busy work. They've lost their passion. They've lost their desire. And the only reason they show up is to make themselves feel better or to make somebody else feel better about them. It's the sad truth today. But Jesus does not want you to be in busy work. So let me make this clear. My goal for you today is not for you to stop coming to church or to stop working at church. My goal for you is for you not to stop cleaning your house. Please keep cleaning your house. My goal for you today is to stop doing busy work. Stop doing busy work. Create enough margin in your life that you can spend time in the presence of God. You need the presence of God. You will die without the presence of God. You need the presence of God more than you need one more ministry at church. You need the presence of God more than you need that overtime. You need the presence of God more than anything else in your life. You need the presence of God. And so some of you need to learn to say no. Learn to say no. And inevitably, I'll ask somebody to do something this week and you'll tell me no. But that's okay. When somebody asks you to do something, pray about it. Don't just say yes. Pray about it. Do God things, not good things. Not everything that sounds good is God's will for your life. Make sure when you say yes, it is a God thing. You don't need to be busier. You need to spend time in the presence of God. For some of you, the Lord may be leading you to do a new ministry, but as you head into that new ministry, lay an old one down. You can't do it all. Stop thinking that you are Superman or Superwoman. You may have to lay a few things down so that you can pick up what God has for you in your future. Not every good thing is a God thing. You may have to lay down some good things so that you can see God move in your life. God's desire for you is for you to be able to rest in His presence. To just be able to take a deep breath and say, I'm at peace with God. It might not be easy to lay down good things, but I will guarantee you that it will be worth it in the end. It'll be worth it. Let me pray for us this morning. Father, we come to You and we thank You for everything that You've done. God, we thank You that we can rest in Your presence. God, for many of us this morning, we're burdened down under the weight of good things. God, I pray that in this moment, You would release those chains of obligation and that You would free us from those thoughts of that we have to do everything. God, I pray that You would do a work in our church, Father. I pray that we wouldn't be about busy work, but God, that we could be effective. God, that we could be doing meaningful ministry, that we could really be changing lives and not just putting on a show. God, make us into the people that You want us to be, God. Your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. God, we love You this morning and we thank You. And it's through Jesus we pray.